And welcome to the second meeting in 2023 of the Scottish Commission of Public Audit. Two of our members, Sharon Dowie and Mark Russell, are attending remotely today. And the first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
So, second item on our agenda is to take evidence on Audit Scotland's budget proposal for 2024-25. And members can find a copy of the budget proposal along with a covering letter from the Auditor General in paper one of the meeting papers. Now, welcome to the meeting, Stephen Boyle, Auditor General for Scotland, Alan Alexander, Chair of the Board of Audit Scotland, Martin Walker, Director of Corporate Support, and Stuart Dennis, Corporate Finance Manager, Audit Scotland. And I would like to invite Professor Alexander and then the Auditor General to make short introductory statements.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning to you and to the members of the Commission. As usual, we are very happy to talk you through the proposal and answer any questions that you have. As I don't need to remind you, this year, Audit Scotland, the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission published our joint statement of purpose, Public Audit in Scotland. This sets out our vision for public audit, our mission, and the four outcome areas where we want to have a measurable impact by 2028. We've also published Audit Scotland's corporate plan for the period, and which explains how the organisation will deliver on these ambitions. Public Audit in Scotland and the corporate plan set the context for our operational and financial planning over the next 5 years, and thus the context and timeframe for the considerations today. Alongside Public Audit in Scotland and the corporate plan, we've also finalised a new partnership working framework between the Accounts Commission, the Auditor General and Audit Scotland. The budget supports the shared ambitions and operations of all three, and the Accounts Commission has had assurance from both the Audit Scotland budget setting process and from its interim chair sitting on the board during that period, and while this proposal was approved for submission to you. Over the year 2024 to 25, we'll build on the huge amount of work already done in recent years. The Commission's support has been invaluable in that, and we're very grateful for it. We'll work to maintain and increase the impact of our work and its continuing relevance. All of us here today are well aware of the intense pressures on public services and finances, and the external circumstances affecting us and the bodies we audit. And that's been at the centre of the governance of the budget process at Audit Scotland over the last 5 months. In that kind of environment, robust, independent, relevant public audit is crucial. If we are to achieve our ambitions, we have to continue to modernise the way we deliver audit and how we work, while protecting the proven and resilient Scottish public audit model. This model has thus far protected Scotland from the significant problems in public audit elsewhere in the UK. Now, that, of course, is reassuring, and I think reassuring to the public sector in general. But we cannot and we will not be complacent. Over the next 5 years, we'll build on and enhance the Scottish model and the quality assurance and scrutiny it provides. This budget, as well as being the operational budget, is year one of that programme. With your permission, Chair, I'll hand over now to Stephen Boyle as Accountable Officer for Audit Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks, Alan. Good morning, Chair. Good morning, Commission members. Alan has set out the context for our budget proposal this morning, together with Audit Scotland's work over the coming years, namely to deliver public audit in Scotland and drive measurable change across our four intended outcomes. Over the past year, we have continued to deliver the annual audits of almost 300 public sector entities, as well as performance audits on matters of significant public interest. That hasn't been easy, and Chair, I think I would like to take the opportunity to thank my colleagues in Audit Scotland, as well as those in the firms that both the Accounts Commission and I appoint to deliver public audit. Our draft budget proposal today supports the delivery of the work we do in the ongoing challenging financial environment that all public bodies in Scotland operate in. The volatility and pressure facing public finances not only inform the work that we do, but also how we operate as an organisation. We will balance the ongoing delivery of high-quality, independent audit with an audit modernisation programme, ensuring that our audit approach remains fit for purpose in the years to come. Our resource requirement for 2024-2025 is £13.2 million, an increase of £1.03 million. This comprises three areas. The first is the increasing cost of delivering audits, both for us and the firms we contract, together with increasing costs operating our business. This is where members can compare our requirement for 24-25 directly with 23-24, and that amounts to a 4.7% increase. The second area, accounting for a 1.9% increase, is the biennial National Fraud Initiative. This is an added cost every 2 years and an extremely important exercise for us. As I'm sure the Commission will be familiar, to date the NFI has achieved £158.5 million in outcomes for the Scottish public sector. The third area covers the fees for newly created public bodies that we cannot directly charge audit fees for, together with additional audit work needed for other bodies where we also are unable to charge a fee. For context, our budget has decreased in real terms by a fifth over the past decade, while the volume of work has increased. Our total proposed budget of £37.6 million equates to 0.06% of Scotland's public sector spend of £59.6 billion. In 23-24, we faced a number of higher than expected costs. The largest was for our staff pay award, an area of focus, of course, across the Scottish public sector. Last year, we managed to absorb some of these costs, but our 24-25 budget proposal reflects a new pay cost baseline. We hope to agree a pay award for the 24-25 year with our colleagues earlier than we have done in previous years. The completion of our annual audit work against planned timescales is not yet as good as we would like it to be. Nonetheless, we are on track to meet our target timescale of returning to a 95% delivery of annual audits by 2028. For context, around half of local government's audits in Scotland were delivered to the planned deadline. Almost all will be done by the end of this month. These audits will be, at most, therefore, a few months late, and as Alan alluded to, not years late, as is the case in many public sector audits in England. In 24-25 and in future years, we will continue that recovery progress. Our budget proposal aims to strike the robust balance between efficiencies and ensuring that we are delivering effective public audit. For example, through our estate strategy, we will start to see annual savings from April 2025. Lastly, Chair, I would like to quickly update you on our employer pension costs. Since submitting the draft proposal to the SCPA, we have received a draft actuarial valuation and indicative contribution rates about our membership of the local government pension scheme. It suggests that our rate will be lower than has been accounted for in our proposal and that the Commission will be familiar with in previous years. These are indicative and draft at the moment, but we expect to receive a decision from the pension scheme by late March 2024 and will of course engage further with the SCPA once we have clarity on the expected rates and resultant spend. Chair, members, very grateful for the opportunity to provide opening statements and look forward to answering your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Before I open it to questions for members, perhaps I could say one thing. You know, we're in a fairly challenging financial situation in the public sector, and I know members will be keen to look fairly closely at the 8.4% overall increase that Audit Scotland's proposing. I think it would not be wrong to say that in general increases in the public sector are fairly limited at the moment, many thinking that if they get an even increase or non-increase, that they've come out well. So I think that all that should come out during the questioning today, and hopefully we'll get to the conclusion of that. Let me start with the first question, which is about the fact that we welcome the fact you didn't look for additional funding, revenue funding in 2023-24 in the spring budget revision. But can you tell me what steps you took to identify the significant efficiency savings that have been used to alleviate particularly staff cost pressures and fund capital investments? And that's particularly in view of the extent of the challenges and risks to the 2023-24 budget that you previously reported to the Commission.
Yeah, I'm very happy to start on that, and I'll perhaps bring Martin and Stuart in to support my response, Chair. You're right, actually, our budget proposal last year wasn't followed up with any supplementary requests to the Commission, and we are pleased to get to that outcome. I think when we gave evidence to the SCPA on our 23-24 budget proposal, we spoke in terms that there were some significant risks, most notably in terms of the pay award, that our pay assumptions of were considerably lower in percentage terms than we eventually settled on in terms of the actual pay award. So where we got to was around a 6% pay award for our colleagues. That wasn't a flat 6% for everybody. Through negotiation with our trade union partners, there was some what we referred to as bottom loading, so more generous pay awards for colleagues at earlier stages of their career or lower paid roles within Audit Scotland. In terms of balancing the budget effectively, we're always mindful of our costs as a public body, Chair, so that we are rightly living up to the standards that we expect of other public bodies in terms of managing our budget. Part of the factors that we use to respond to that, some are longer term, some are in the year, and I'm sure you want to talk about our estate strategy and our approach to managing over the course of evidence taking this morning. But in terms of some of the examples, we did employ what we call a vacancy factor arrangement within the organisation, so that it builds in an assumption around turnover levels and how quickly we can fill posts within the organisation. That was perhaps our most significant approach to managing our cost approach. We're also looking closely at our kind of wider delivery arrangements and other efficiencies. How we're delivering our audits is also changing. So some of our expectations around travel and subsistence that we would have recognised being quite a significant cost in previous years were also lower than expected. So we were able to reapply some of that cost over the course of the year. Those are some high-level examples, Chair, but maybe Martin might want to come in with some further specifics, or indeed Stuart. Martin.
Thanks, Stephen. As Stephen said, we focus very closely on our productivity and our efficiency. We're very mindful of every pound that goes into public audit isn't going into other public services. And given the nature of what we work and the work that we do, we're obviously very focused on that. I think the other thing that's probably worth reminding members as well is that any of the unused budget in year is, of course, returned to the Scottish Consolidated Fund. And over the course of recent years, that has been fairly routine, and that we've been able to pay back into the SCF for any of the budget that isn't used in year. We aren't in a position to keep reserves. It is an annual process for us, and so we always return anything that's unused to the Scottish Consolidated Fund.
Okay. You mentioned about travel, and indeed travel costs have reduced over the years. But I think, and I'm talking from memory here, I think you're talking about a 95,000 increase on travel costs this year.
I'm just checking that from the Appendix 1, Chair, and I'll ask Stuart to clarify. I think our budget proposal for travel and subsistence costs for the forthcoming year is 402,000 compared to the budget of last year of 496,000. So I think I'm just over a reduction of £94,000 in our travel and subsistence.
I will hunt through for that later. But the measures that you've taken in 23-24, are you applying the same measures to 24-25 in terms of cost management?
Yeah, at a high level, yes, absolutely right. So I think the one example we've just spoken about in terms of travel and subsistence is a significant area of expenditure that we'll always keep under close review. I think it's likely going to take us into particularly looking at how we are managing kind of areas of our expenditure. As the Commission know, most of our costs are staff costs together with payments that we make to firms that we appoint. So that accounts for 86% of our total spend. Looking at our estate, and I'll maybe pass to Stuart to say a bit more about how we're managing our estate's costs into the future. But we're also looking at ways to ensure that as an organisation we remain both fit for purpose but are managing our costs, and we are embarking on an audit modernisation approach as well that will primarily look to secure the effectiveness of our audit, that it meets the respective quality standards, but will likely also in due course to ensure that we can demonstrate to the SCPA and public bodies that we are efficient. So those are the approaches, and just as we refer to in our submission, that as we review our approach, we anticipate that that will further down the line bring changes to what we call our operating model, a new target operating model. The detail of that is something we intend to develop over the course of 24-25. I can stop for a moment, Chair, and maybe I think particularly the estate, Stuart, can come in and update the Commission on where we've reached with that. Stuart.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen. Good morning, everybody. It's in respect to the estates, you'll notice that the budget in respect of rent and rates is actually required to go up next year. That is an interim arrangement because we're in the middle of trying to reduce the size of our office in Edinburgh, and we've expanded the office size in Glasgow, which it meets our demand. So what's happening is the plan is that next year, potentially we might have some savings in year, depending on how quickly the work can be done in Edinburgh. But the board have approved a state strategy that reduces the size of the Edinburgh office and increases in Glasgow, because that's where the demand is. So what we're looking at doing there is over the long term, the duration of that, the net position is likely to bring in excess of £2 million worth of savings over a 10-year period. In respect of Edinburgh, by reducing the office by a third, the actual savings on that office alone over the duration of the extended lease will be in the region of £4 million. But it's not as much, it's a net position because we've had to increase our capacity in Glasgow because that's where the demand is. So in the longer term, we are delivering significant savings in respect of our estate. On the back of travel and subsistence, just to highlight, in 2019-20 budget, we had a budget of 852,000. You'll notice that this year we're asking for 402. So obviously that's taken a significant impact on how we do audit and the approach we take. So this is the impact of that. And we feel that that's a fair reflection now. Now that we're out of the previous lockdowns, we feel we're now into a more steady position in respect of travel and subsistence. Well, I would also...
Travel and subsistence. Your proposed budget is 402,000. Your budget for last year was 496,000. Interestingly, there's no comparison to the actual for 23-24. What is the actual for 23-24?
At the minute, we're within...
You're still within that year, therefore you haven't got a figure.
I haven't got a figure for the year, but year-to-date, we are underspent in that area.
Substantially?
Not substantially, no.
Not substantially?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I think just on the... the 402,000 is informed by the forecast that we get to the end of March. So there's a degree of fluctuation, but I think what we're confident on the 400,000 is reflective of what we'll likely spend. And I think you can probably take confidence from the fact that Stuart's saying it's not substantially underspent, is that we are able to track what our progress will be. So in understanding of patterns, the one change that's also relevant for this budget is that this will be the first full year of the new appointment round of auditors as well. So there's not a direct comparison with previous budget actual spends. This is informed by what we've been spending in the delivery of audits and then what we expect it will be in years to come. If it would be helpful, Chair, maybe I'm keen to bring Alan in just to give you a bit of some of the governance of our efficiency and how we are monitoring our programme of cost and savings. Alan.
Thanks, Stephen. Chair, members, one of the constant refrains that I feed in to Audit Scotland is the need for us to be continuously an exemplar to the bodies we audit. The worst position we could get ourselves into would be to be accused of saying, do what we say, not what we do. So I've been very firm on that from the moment that I became chair. And in this particular budget process, we have given the process challenge and governance over the last 5 months that I referred to in my introduction. So what I mean by that is, on top of the continuous monthly meetings and more if necessary that I have with the accountable officer and the chief operating officer, we've had a board seminar in which we looked at where we were going financially, both in terms of the year to which this bid would refer and also what we saw coming down the track over the next 4 years beyond that. And we then followed that up with two full board meetings on the budget proposals as they were developed. One in September, another in November, and that latter one we proceeded with by an informal, smaller group meeting of the people you see around this table, myself and the chief operating officer, just to make sure that there was no there was nothing in the budget proposal that we could see as being frankly indefensible. And we found some of that early on. We didn't find any later on. So, you know, we're fairly confident that this has been a well-governed process. We would hope that it sets us on a good footing to move into the period when the audit modernisation process will come back to you in budget years later. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to move on now to invite Daniel Johnson, if he's got any questions.
Thank you. I mean, just picking up on that, and I just really want to re-emphasise the point the convener made, in that looking at the coming financial year, the public sector financial settlements are likely to be extremely challenging. And against that context, 8.4% will, I think, be difficult by way of comparison to justify in comparison to other public sector bodies. I mean, just in terms of the point that was just made about kind of essentially living by the guidance that you were providing those public sector bodies, is that not inviting at least that challenge by making that statement?
I think, without context, I would expect significant pushback and challenge. But I think the context explains the rationale for why our proposal is as it is before you today. One is around National Fraud Initiative, and that accounts for 1.9% of the 8.4. We think that is an essential mechanism to both support financial control, good use of public money, that it's a biennial process means that it's not a direct comparison with previous year's budget. So on top of that, we're also not comparing like for like because there is a change in the number of bodies that we're auditing as well. So as the Scottish Government has created new bodies, and indeed we expect next year as the Parliament creates new bodies with additional commissioners, we have to respond to that in public audit context. So Environmental Standards Scotland, Consumer Scotland are not fee-charging bodies. And similarly, as our audit work on the European Agricultural Funds ends, part of that work will become part of the Scottish Government audit, which is similarly a non-chargeable audit for us too, Mr Johnson. So those two elements account for 3.7% of our budget proposal change. So if we strip those out, we're talking about, we're requesting, I should say, of a 4.7% increase to our budget.
Can I just ask you to come up, how many additional public bodies are you going to have to be auditing in the coming financial year compared to the current?
I'll give you the detail, and I'll turn to colleagues actually just to make sure I get that list correct. So we are, so I mentioned two of them, in fact, two plus the additional work on the European Agricultural Funds, which will be absorbed as part of our audit of the Scottish Government consolidated accounts. But just turning to Martin, actually, and Stuart. I think those are the complete list, but if there's any others, okay. Mr Johnson, we can come back to.
I mean, in that context, I mean, I think what's incumbent on us is to really understand the robustness of the figures that you've come back with. And I think in particular, how you've sought to find efficiency savings to absolutely contain your budget request within the challenging fiscal envelope that we find ourselves. So can I just ask, in terms of Appendix three, where you set out your efficiency savings, can we just confirm that all of those efficiency savings have been applied to the breakdown of your budget in Appendix one?
Yes, that's correct.
So can I then ask, looking at Appendix 1, if I look at especially the total other operating expenditure, we're seeing a figure of 5.3 million as compared to 3.9 million in 21-22. That's a 37% increase in non-people costs. Is that correct?
In terms of your arithmetic, yes, that's correct. I can develop that further.
Yes, please.
So what has also happened in the intervening period is that we have tendered for the provision of external audit services from for the audit of public bodies, and that has resulted in, as we anticipated it would, to be absolutely clear, increasing costs from audit firms that we appoint for the delivery of audit work. Looking at the cost of audit across, certainly in the UK context, that audit costs are going up, and that is captured in the change in the numbers that you see before you, but happy to go through different lines and capturing some of those costs if that would be helpful.
There are very few lines which are going down, and that's obviously to be expected that in an inflationary environment that we will see increases. But I think if I was looking at a budget proposal where I felt an organisation was absolutely looking rigorously at every possible, I would hope to see a few more lines, maybe flat or decreasing, especially for non-people costs. I mean, just for example, your stationery and printing budget, given that you were able to operate almost half your proposed budget in 21-22, I would just wonder whether or not line items like that have been fully explored as to whether or not they could be reduced.
So I can give you the assurance that we exercise proper scrutiny of the submissions before you. And there are some fluctuations looking at, and in the context, which I agree with you absolutely, is that we are in and have been in an inflationary environment, and that is feeding through to some of our own costs. So Of those that are reducing, we've touched on travel and subsistence, very clear for how we're delivering our audits. We're looking at a change from last year. In some ways, if I can maybe look, the table isn't complete to give it that full trend analysis. 21-22, there were some real anomalies in that year, sure, during, you know, the height of the pandemic. And I think, as Stuart's mentioned, going back further might provide that assurance that, you know, we have real close scrutiny over some of the numbers that we're in. And we are also operating in some of a cyclical environment as well. If you take some of our staff recruitment costs, so you'll see from the appendix that we were in the region of £235,000-240,000 of costs as we changed at the earlier part of this decade. And you know, people's working patterns changed. We had to, you know, bring in different additional people into the organisation. And as we're moving into a more stable environment, we expect some of those costs to go down. And to absolutely want to assure you, Mr. Johnson, and the Commission, that we have gone through these costs, but equally happy to answer any specifics further as you wish.
Well, look, I'd just like to relieve my fellow Commission members. I'm not going to go line by line in, through Appendix 1, but just my final question, I mean, just looking at this, I mean, most of the line items, I understand what they are, but what is contained within other accommodation costs? Just given that, again, it's seeing an increase over £100,000 from £445,000 to £592,000 in a single year. What's actually contained that, given that it's not rent and rates and it's not travel and subsistence?
I'll ask Stuart to give you the detail on that, Stuart.
Yeah, what will be included there is the service charges for the leases that we have, as well as cleaning, utility charges, that they would have gone up. They have gone up significantly as part of the increase in utility bills, and that's why it's gone up so much, is the service charge element, as well as cleaning and also the direct utility bills that we get as well. That's the primary things that would be in there. I would also highlight that under other, you'll see that the actuals in 21-22 and 22-23 are low, but then you've got a high 500. That is where our management contingency is, which is what we have every year, because we can't carry reserves, so we need some contingency there. So whilst we might not actually spend that under the actuals, which are shown in those 2 years, we do require that as part of our budget, and that's a significant sum.
Thank you. I'll leave my questions there, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Sean Dowie to come in?
Thank you, and apologies for not being there in person this morning. Can I ask, in paragraph 9 on page 6, Audit Scotland's reported that the recovery from the disruption to audit completion deadlines continues, while the focus remains on our key priorities of health, safety and wellbeing of colleagues and quality of audit. Can I ask if you could give us more detail and explain the status of the recovery to pre-pandemic audit reporting timelines and advise when you expect it to return to pre-pandemic service levels?
Good morning, Ms. Dowie. I'm happy to start now, and I might turn to Martin, actually, just to develop my response. I think, as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, we haven't yet recovered our delivery deadlines across our audits. We don't particularly like to too readily compare ourselves to other parts of the UK, recognising that there are particular challenges in the delivery of local audit in England. We want to deliver timely, effective, high-quality audits of Scottish public bodies as soon as possible after the end of the financial year. As I mentioned, in our audit of local government bodies, almost all will be completed by the end of this month, which represents, you know, a delay against the completion deadline of the end of September. The deadlines have changed, I should say, over the course of the pandemic. So for some period of time, we were operating to the end of October for councils, And then for NHS bodies, we're now back at an end of June deadline, whereas we, over the course of COVID, we operated to at some points August and then July. In terms of where we are in specifics of progress, Martin can touch on that. I'll maybe finish by saying that we are making progress, especially just having seen some of the more recent detail. This is the first year of the current five-year audit appointment round. That typically brings in some additional time for auditors as they get to know their new audited bodies and vice versa. Allowing for that, we're a good bit further forward in terms of where we were last year. And then similarly, we've set this deadline of 2028, which is the duration of this appointment round, to fully recover. We expect to meet that and hopefully outperform that deadline. We'll continue to report progress. We have effective governance around it, and Alan may want to say more on it too, through our quarterly performance reporting arrangements that tracks the progress that we are making. Specifics, Martin can update, and Alan may want to come in further too. But I'll go to Martin first.
Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, there's a few things at play here. As the Auditor General mentioned, a range of factors that have contributed to the impact of timeliness, and it isn't where we would like it to be. We would obviously like to be ahead of where we are at the moment, but as the Auditor General has said, there's very clear indications that when you look at the deadlines, bearing in mind that they shifted, our timeliness has actually improved this year compared to last. The response, well, we're taking a risk-based approach. Indeed, the earlier conversation that we had about resources available to us, you know, one way to get the audits back on track would be to come to the Commission and say, can we have more resources to get more auditors to close that gap? And very clearly, as the conversation earlier on has highlighted, we didn't think that was a reasonable position to take. So it is about bringing the deadlines or bringing the timeliness of the delivery back on track within the existing resource envelope that we've got. As at close of play on Thursday, all of the health audits were complete. 68% of the local government audits are complete. In the world of central government, we expect 99% to be done by the statutory deadline of the 31st of this month. And we also expect that all of the further education colleges will be complete by its statutory deadline, which is the 30th of the 4th, 24. The other thing that may be of interest as well is that we've done some analysis as to what it is that's leading to the delays in delivery. And that's telling us that around about a half is actually due to issues within the audited bodies themselves in terms of the production of the accounts to the appropriate standard and so on. About 25% is down to delays in the audit process. So that's the delays that are down to us. Another 20%, which is to do with other factors. So the timing of pension fund valuations, the impact from previous years and so on. So we've had a careful look to have a look at what it is that's within our control to be able to make the improvements that we want to make on timeliness, but also being mindful of some other factors which are out with our control. But overall, the timeliness is going in the right direction, certainly. And as the Auditor General said, what we think we've taken is a very sort of practical and reasonable approach to bringing the deadlines back on track.
Thanks for that. I think you'd actually said that in your comment earlier on, Auditor General, that it was months late rather than years late. So just to find, are there any key areas that are still to be audited that are behind schedule that you're concerned about?
So there's nothing I'm concerned about in that I think we are aware of the delivery of audits across the piece, Ms. Dowie, so we are in regular dialogue with auditors working for Audit Scotland and those that we appoint from the firm so that we have a clear understanding of when audits will be forecast. I'll bring Alan in a second, who can say a bit more about, you know, how we are exercising effective governance around this. One comment I would make before for doing so, and Martin referred to this, is that there are statutory deadlines in place here. And I know you, Ms. Dowie, will be familiar with some of the audited bodies who have struggled to meet the statutory deadline. Sometimes those are accompanied by statutory reports from me to the Public Audit Committee, where for those audits that I appoint the auditors for, in the event that those won't meet the statutory deadline, I'll be writing to the Public Audit Committee before the end of this month to let them know where the deadline won't be met. I expect that will be a very small number this year, and audit bodies that you will be familiar with from previous years. Alan, anything you want to add?
Chair, let me just say something about the way the board approaches this. I mentioned in my opening statement the corporate plan. That's supported by a business plan, and both are supported by a suite of reports that come to every board meeting. And I think it's fair to say that the board gives as much scrutiny to performance as it does to expenditure over the year. And behind that, the board has taken a very significant view that when push comes to shove, timetable of audit can be negotiable, quality of audit can't. And that, these are the kind of bounding factors that are around coming back to the kind of timetables that we hope to get to by 2028. The other thing I think to say is that what the information that comes to the board demonstrates, and is now demonstrating in more granular detail than it did even 6 months ago, is that the reasons for delay, as Martin has just highlighted, vary, and quite a lot of it is out with the control of Audit Scotland. I think the other thing is that delays vary. You know, when we've asked, the board has asked for the detail on how long delays are to be part of the report to it. Because there is a distinction to be made, as I'm sure the Commission will accept, between an audit that, picking a figure out of the air, is 3 months late, and an audit which is 3 weeks late, and the reasons are likely to be different. But I just wanted to assure the Commission that budget and audit quality are jobs one and two for the board, and I think we now are in a position that the board gets a greater degree of granularity in both of these than it did before, and also that before they come to the board, they have been crawled over in great detail by the audit committee at each of its meetings. Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to ask about the new bodies to be audited in 24-25, but that's now been covered by Daniel Johnson, so just back over to you now, Chair. Thanks.
Thank you. Just on the back of Sharon Dowie's comments, how has the delayed audits impacted on cash flow and the changed deadlines? How does that impact on cash flow? I mean, where does that place you?
So Stuart can give you the detail in this, Chair, but I think my, if I go out on a limb, not terribly, is the answer, is that we'll still be billing for those bodies that we're able to charge a fee for in line with our cyclical approach. The challenge you might recall we had right at the start of COVID was that it had a very significant bearing on our work in progress and income recognition. That meant that we weren't able to bank, as it were, the work that we would normally to align our income and expenditure, and that left us with a technical accounting gap that we received the support of the SCPA for a budget revision at that stage. Cash flow terms, I think it's different, but Stuart can I clarify.
Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, that's right. In respect to cash flow, it's not a great impact. What we have is we operate on an instalment basis, so we will invoice on three instalments, so local government, central government and NHS. We invoice usually in January, May and September, so we might not have finished the audits, but we've invoiced for the work. From a cash flow perspective, we've got the cash in. And as Stephen says, it's more a case of when we can recognise the income in the accounts, because if we haven't finished the work yet, we can only recognise what we've done. So, but from a cash flow perspective, it's not a huge impact.
So you have a system for work in progress?
Yes.
Okay.
To say more on that, Chair, yes, we absolutely do. It's a key factor in how we account and prepare our accounts. Our external auditors quite rightly recognise this as an area of audit risk for them, and it's of significant focus during the audit that they are satisfied that the numbers we are reporting as progress on individual audits, bearing in mind that the audit year is not the same as our financial year, so there's a cut-off point for our balance sheet date, but that's subject to external audit each year, so that they're satisfied with the numbers.
So are all the bodies that are being audited done on the basis of three invoices a year?
In mind, it's other than further education, which get two invoices a year, but that's how we operate, is that they will get three, in principle, three invoices, an initial one, a second fee invoice, and then the final invoice. And by that time, the first invoice we issue will be on the expected fee. The auditor will then, as part of their planning process, have meetings with the audited body, and it might well be then that the actual expected fee that we have initially invoiced for, they might agree a higher fee because there might be more work and more risk. So in that case, the next instalment, we will then do that based on the adjusted fee that's been agreed with the audited body.
Okay, thank you. Can I bring Richard Leonard in at this point?
Yeah, good morning, everybody. I just wanted to really develop that point, because one of the things that stood out for me was Table 2, which is your budgeted expected income from various sources, various public bodies whom you charge fees for. And if I read that table correctly, what it tells me is that the proposal is that the fees, audit fees charged to colleges, further education colleges, will rise by 6%. The income generated from the fees charged to local government and the National Health Service bodies will increase by 8.7%. And the expected fee income from central government bodies and Scottish Government departments and sponsored bodies is projected to decline by 1.3%. Well, I mean, what's the strategy that lies behind that?
Yeah, I'm glad you raised this, Mr. Leonard. Actually, there is some important clarification we can make, I think, particularly with reference to our overall request. So colleges, quite straightforward, that is 6%. And our overall fee increase for the 23-24 audit year will be 6%. There is an alignment with our fee increases to our staff pay award. And that's why there is a mismatch is to do with the overlap of our audit years and our financial years. Stuart can develop this for the next point to make sure you get the absolute clarity with which the Commission needs on this point, and particularly picking up the point about why is central government out of line with the other sectors. Stuart.
Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, table two reflects the financial year income. As Stephen says, what we do is we charge for the audit year, and in here, the Scottish Government figures, sponsor body, has actually gone down because that's where our EFA audit used to be. So that was over £500,000. So we're no longer going to have that audit in 24-25. And that's why that's come down in total. You'll see that the NHS and local authorities have gone, are a bit higher than the sick. We're increasing their fees by 6% for 23-24 audits, but there is some expectation of catch-up that has been discussed earlier, and this is what we're hoping to do in the income budget, is that we will be able to recognise a bit more of that income in respect of we will catch up in those sectors. So whilst we're not charging them anymore, what we're doing is we're completing more of the work in those sectors and able to recognise more of that income come the end of March 25. So we've budgeted that into our plans.
Okay, but for us as a commission, it's useful to be able to compare one financial year with the next financial year, comparing apples with apples. So I don't know whether there's a better way you could present that information. I mean, so can I deduce from what you've told us then that the fees that you are charging to Scottish Government departments and sponsored bodies of the Scottish Government are also rising by 6%?
For those bodies where we are able to charge a fee.
Of course.
And just to be absolutely clear, there is a 6% is the fee increase for all audited bodies for that year in question. I take the point, and it's very fair you make about the compare and contrast isn't as straightforward because of some of the variables that Stuart mentions, that you know, we're accelerating the work as part of the catch-up of delivery progress, and there are new bodies thrown into the mix, together with the fact that the income that we had been receiving from the IFA, Agricultural Funds Audits, is also changing fundamentally, and as it moves out of our responsibility by the middle of next year. It's maybe one, Chair, we need to take away and just see if there's anything we can come back to the Commission in writing just to give you that comparability that you're looking for.
Thanks. I think that that would certainly be a useful thing to do. One of the other areas where I was struggling a little bit to make the comparisons and to understand the narrative that's in the submission to us is around the estate strategy. So... and it may be, I think Stuart might have clarified this a little bit earlier on for me, but anyway, just so I'm clear about this, if I look at the overall figure for property, we're told that there's going to be an estimated financial saving in the region of £2.2 million over a 10-year period, that is, though. So it's, what, £220,000 a year as an average. We're also told in paragraph... 78, that the Glasgow accommodation cost rise is in the region of £298,000. I mean, again, presumably, so I'm comparing apples with apples. That's a one-year figure versus the 10-year figure for the net saving. I mean, again, it's helpful if the units are immediately comparable, and I'm not sure that one necessarily is. So could you perhaps develop that and explain to us... what the increased costs are, what the decreased costs are, what the net position is over a one-year, three-year, 10-year period.
Yeah, certainly. I think we'll do our best to cover all of those points. If we don't have all of the detail to hand, again, we may follow through in writing just so the Commission is clearly cited on it. I'll maybe start, Mr. Leonard, and then bring Stuart and Martin might want to add as well. As Stuart has touched on already, I think we've engaged with the Commission in previous discussions on our budget proposal. We recognised that post-COVID is that our estate wasn't right for how we would be delivering our work in the years to come, particularly the case with our Glasgow and Edinburgh offices. To summarise, Edinburgh is too big for our purposes and Glasgow not big enough. We were able in Glasgow to remain in the same location, which is in the centre of the city in Nelson Mandela Place, and acquire a vacant unit in the same building on the same floor to meet the demands that we have of our colleagues. Our Glasgow office for many years has been too small, typically over capacity, and resulting in circumstances of business inefficiency, colleagues finding themselves unable to have a desk when they needed it, not good enough for how we wanted to operate. We also find that Stuart has again touched on is that we're able to recruit more easily in Glasgow than we have in other parts of the country. The nature of our workforce is one that will go where the audits need to take place, but they also need to have a base. So Glasgow is an investment for the future of where we expect to deliver our work and meet the needs of our people. Briefly on our Edinburgh office, we found, again, through tracking some of the analysis that Martin and his team are doing about usage of the office and the extent to which we find ourselves with considerable free space in that office, allowing for changes in the lease arrangements that we have and expiration, we've taken the opportunity with some of the anticipated support of the Commission to plan for changes to downsize some of the Edinburgh office. Looking in the round, as you mentioned some of the figures, that will produce savings over the longer term as part of an estate strategy that is both comprises investment and also reduction. Some of that investment is set out in the anticipated requirements for next year to allow for some of the changes that we're making in both Edinburgh and Glasgow. Probably enough from me, and I'll maybe bring Stuart in first of all, and then Martin.
Yeah, I'm happy to provide more information. As you can imagine, we've got detailed breakdowns of how the savings and the additional costs have been collected and just summarised in the report that you've seen before you. What I would say is that what we're doing is recycling as much furniture and everything that we can as part of this as well. So it's not like a new ask or anything. What we're doing is in respect of what we're giving up in Edinburgh, what we will be doing is the furniture that is spare will be moving across to Glasgow where we can. So we're cutting down costs and reusing furniture that we require there. There is a general uplift, as you're probably aware, in respect of utility charges and the impact that's having on service charges that we have with the landlords as well. So that's why there is an increase of that scale for next year. But the plan is that will bottom out and start to reduce savings probably in next year, but we're not, it's difficult to put an actual date on it at this present time because we're still in the legal process of the minute of variation for Edinburgh, and then it's the coordination of the whole project for both sites to be able to do that. But there is, as you would expect, there is more detail behind that, and happy to share that with the Commission if they so wish.
Just a couple of other things to add. As Stuart said, we're very focused on ensuring that we recycle office furniture, that kind of stuff. The other thing that's really key, I think, here is that the rental rates in Glasgow are substantially lower than they are in Edinburgh. So by virtue of being able to kind of close off part of the office, and that's all been agreed with the landlord, as soon as that partition goes up, then we start to reap the benefits of paying for a reduced floor space. And that is what is then going into paying for the increase in capacity that we're looking to deliver in Glasgow. And Stuart and I have a meeting with the project team on Thursday afternoon, actually this week, both in terms of the designers, and I believe that the invitation for the expressions of interest relating to the work went out, I think, last week, Stuart, I'm right in saying? Yep. So clearly, once we've got the responses into that tender process, we've had the detailed planning discussions with the external folks, then we'll be much clearer in terms of what the timelines are going to be. Certainly, I know from colleagues, particularly in the West, there is a huge appetite for accessing and using that space. We're able to use the space to a degree at the moment for meetings and so on, but the next key stage for the Glasgow office will essentially be putting the cable in and getting the desks and so on across the excess stuff from Edinburgh through to Glasgow.
But, I mean, can I just understand then that, because you're talking about a revenue to capital budget transfer during this financial year to help meet the cost of that change. How will that be funded in future years? And as I understand it, any savings that we get to are not really going to start to accrue until 2025. So it's not next year, it's the year after, isn't it? Is my interpretation of that correct?
Yeah, you're correct in both those points.
Okay. So what happens between now and April 2025?
I think there is investment required, as Martin and Stuart are touching on, to make the offices suitable to be used. You know, so quite rightly, as you'd expect, we'll reuse as much as we can, but there needs to be cabling put into the vacant suite in Glasgow, partitions where necessary, and then in Edinburgh. I think it's important the Commission kind of hear more about just some of the discussions we've been having with the landlord through our agent. Whenever you return an office suite, you always have dilapidations. You have to return the building back to the condition that you acquired it. Any organisation should be allowing for that, as we had been doing through providing for what our dilapidations would be. But there is work required, not full scale, but changes to the Edinburgh office. But we're going from a footprint down to that we currently have, probably went to about 50-60% of what we currently operate, with partitions going up, making sure we've still got the necessary meeting space, kitchen facilities and so forth. And that, once those works are completed, then we'll start to see the savings that you refer to. If I've missed anything, Stuart.
But again, my very last question then is, so there will be net savings on estates by 2025?
Over the course then through for into the end of this decade and beyond, we expect there will be in over £2 million over that 10-year period thereafter. I can bring Alan, I think he wants to just kind of reassure the committee, I'm sure, about some of the governance around this.
It might be useful to the Commission just to, for context. I say one of the things that I encouraged the board to do was to, as it were, hasten slowly as far as the estates strategy was concerned. As we came out of the pandemic, there was an awful lot of loose talk around about the huge amount of money that could be saved because of working from home. We took the view that we needed to see how that was developing, engage with our staff and feed that in to the process. I mean, I think Stephen, I remember having a conversation with Stephen when we were looking at the possibility of an immediate nearly £1 million saving. But that was making the assumptions that office usage would continue at the kind of levels we saw during the pandemic. And the strategy that the board signed off on, and again, it took us 6 months to do that, was based on a realistic assessment of how our staff would behave, as well as the needs of the business.
OK. Thanks, Chair. That's me.
Thank you. I'd like to turn to the National Fraud Initiative. And you've already touched on it already. You've mentioned some of the savings that have been achieved over a period. But to what extent are the benefits and the outcomes of the NFI examined by you to ensure that we get value for money here, that the value of the savings generated continues to merit the time and effort that's invested into this, both in Scotland and UK-wide? I recall that there's a number of bodies that do not take part in this, and I think, if I remember, housing associations and such like don't participate. And whether any move has been made to try and bring them in, because obviously the more organisations that are part of this, the more effective and cost-effective this will be.
Yeah, many thanks, Chair. Just for completeness, I think I mentioned a figure of £158.5 million as being the financial saving as a result of Scotland's participation in the National Fraud Initiative. That is significant.
Over which period is that?
That is going back to, I'll look to colleagues just to,
2006-07.
Thank you, Stuart. 2006-07. That's so, a number of years spanning, three decades, Chair. But I think what's also true, in addition to the financial saving, is the importance of the deterrent effect that this exercise has, in that all public sector workers are aware of their participation through effective, proper communication from their employer. The data matching goes wider into supplier records as well. The use of blue badge facilities and so forth is another common theme of where the National Fraud Initiative has had its successes over the period. So as an exercise, it's delivering both financial savings and preventing future or potential fraud. And in the round, in my view, looks to enhance the control environment that public sector bodies are operating in. You quite rightly mentioned also, Chair, that the scope of the National Fraud Initiative has also been subject to review. I know that the Public Audit Committee has also taken a strong interest in the National Fraud Initiative in recent years, and we've engaged with that committee on the scope and looked to encourage, I think, is really the first phase of participation of additional bodies, whether it's register social landlords, housing associations, or indeed other bodies that are aligned to the public sector to review their participation. That work is ongoing, and we've had communication and discussion with the Public Audit Committee. I think that what is also true is that there are boundaries. There's that some bodies who aren't compelled to participate willingly do so, but those are small in number, and it would take new legislation, both and from a UK level, to say about the scope of the exercise. I'm still committed to it, Chair. I think it is the right thing to do. I think it gives assurance to the Parliament and the public that all efforts are being made to reduce opportunities for fraud within public sector spending.
Does the Scottish Government not have the power to add organisations to the list of those participating?
I think I would need to refresh my memory, Chair, about the specifics of the legislation. There are both UK responsibilities and to an extent Scottish, but I'm not sure I have that detail to hand and probably need to refer to previous correspondence.
It would be interesting to know because, I mean, obviously it's in everybody's interest that we get the maximum out of this.
Very much so.
And it seems to me there's a large part of the public sector that doesn't seem to be there.
I think, just to reassure you, I think I would probably categorise these as aligned to the public sector as opposed to public sector bodies. All public sector bodies subject to audit by auditors appointed by myself or the Accounts Commission are included in the National Fraud Initiative. Mm. The bodies that aren't are those that are recipients of public funding but not part of the public administration of Scottish public bodies. So, and I think that's where it comes into about the extent to which those bodies want to participate. We hope that the benefits are clear for those organisations, but there isn't an obligation upon them to do so. And that's where you're into the territory of, well, what legislation and the benefits of the Scottish or UK government determining that that is further legislation is required. If you're content, Chair, I may need just to revisit previous correspondence and share that with the Commission.
That would be appreciated. Can I bring Mark Ruskell in at this point?
Thanks, Chair. Morning to the panel. Can I ask you just about the capital budget? I mean, the whole of the capital budget is going on the digital strategy in the next year. I take it then that there's no other capital requirements for the next year beyond the digital strategy. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct, Mr. Ruskell. Good morning. What if maybe just to expand that further, we anticipate as an organisation investing in our IT infrastructure to support our audit arrangements, not so much in the year for our budget proposal in front of you, but in future years. Through our audit methodology programme. We record our audit work on an audit software. We use a product called Pentana at the moment, like many other of the UK audit organisations. Technology is changing, audit approaches are changing. We intend to take the next year, hopefully shorter indeed, just to review our requirements so that our audit approach remains fit for purpose in the short and medium term. That is likely to get us to a point of needing to invest in our audit technology requirements. But in the round, that's something, a project that we'll work on over the course of the coming financial year. So therefore, our capital requirements are as they are set out in our proposal.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so in terms of forecasting what that future capital requirement is then for the digital strategy, can you give us an indication of the scale of that right now? So beyond 2024-25.
So I can bring colleagues in actually, but I think what we want to do in the year ahead is be clear on what our requirements are so that we settle on both digital and working practices that will allow us to deliver robust, independent, effective public audit arrangements. There are options for us, so that there are audit technology solutions available in the market, which we think will be our likely course of action, as opposed to developing an in-house solution. I think just for efficiency, there is no huge value in us trying to source project management, digital skills to develop a solution, one that already exists. I perhaps ought not to preempt where we'll get to, because we will go through that process over the next few months of 2024 and beyond. So I wouldn't want to give a figure to you, Mr. Ruskell, or the Commission this morning that says, and this is what it's likely to be. But rest assured that we will go through effective processes, project management, sizing the scope of the project, along with the necessary governance through our board during 2024.
I think it's fair just to point out, and just following from what Stephen said, that the board is convinced that there will be a need for what we call for shorthand audit modernisation in the period between now and 2028. But it's also clear that in the year to which this budget applies, we will be wanting to see a robust business case for what we should do and what it's likely to cost. And clearly, that will have longer term than 1 year implications, because if we go for something that is in the market rather than developing something in-house, there will be continuing fees for that. And I don't think we know at the moment exactly what the scope of that will be, but we will know that over the next 6 to 9 months.
Yeah. And obviously, you know, if there's a point within that 6 to 9 months where there's more clarity, then we would be interested in the details being shared with us as well. Can I sort of move on then and just ask you about pay and the pay negotiations? I mean, obviously you're not able to discuss in any kind of detail where you're at this point and what a likely potential pay award may be for the next year. But I suppose if I could sort of frame the question by asking you more about last year. As you said in initial comments, I think you budgeted for a 3% pay increase. You landed with a 6% pay increase, and you know, I think that's obviously extremely welcome for your staff, and you know, you already explained the kind of element of bottom loading for those staff that are on lower salaries. But perhaps if I could ask you what you kind of learned from that process of pay negotiation last year, and how that then feeds into your assessment of what a potential pay award may be for this year, and critically, what you're budgeting for at this point, and what you're therefore asking the SCPA to support you with.
Yeah, many thanks. I'm happy to start, Mr. Ruskell, and perhaps Martin, and indeed Alan might want to say a bit more, both looking ahead and reflections on last year too. First thing I would say, we're really grateful for the effective relationship that we have with our trade union partners in arriving at a terms and conditions settlement that we reached over the past few weeks. One reflection I would have absolutely is we want to do this sooner. So as a result of the timing of the completion, we were able to make sure that our colleagues received their pay award and the associated backdated pay at the end of November. We want to do it much sooner in 2024, so that we're not either in a process of long negotiations and that people get the pay award when they are due. So that is very clearly our ambition for next year, and a process that we've already started discussions with the trade union too. As I mentioned in one of my earlier answers, we knew that this was a risk when we put our budget proposal to the SCPA last year of 3%, and then eventually settling on 6%. Through careful budget management, vacancy factors, looking at our spending profile, we were able to source or identify how we would pay for the pay awards during the course of the financial year. I mentioned in my introductory remarks that pay award has now been baselined and is part of our budget proposal to the SCPA this morning. Looking to next year, I'm grateful for your recognition that because we're in a process of negotiation and not yet settled on that I'm not able to be absolutely specific about what our assumptions are around pay awards are, but that they are very clearly referenced to public sector pay arrangements in Scotland. The Commission, I'm sure, recalls that Audit Scotland is not bound by the Scottish Government's public sector pay policy. We do want to very clearly take cognizance of that, and also what the market expects, requires of us to remain competitive as an audit organisation delivering public audit. So these are all the factors that we're weighing up as part of our negotiations, and that we'll have hopefully soon, and hopefully fruitful early conclusion with our trade unions into the early part of 2024. I'm optimistic, Mr. Ruskell, but certainly we'll remain in regular dialogue and discussion with the SCPA to keep you abreast of our progress. But I'll turn to Martin, first of all, and then indeed Alan, if there's anything you want to add.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yeah, in terms of the negotiating process, it's been interesting over the course of the last couple of years because, of course, the kind of national position and the national position that PCS has taken has shifted a little bit, where last year, for example, or the year that we're in now, there was a little bit more of local flexibility that was available than perhaps had been the case previously. I would describe the working relationship that we've got with the union, and particularly through our partnership forum and the pay and reward negotiating meetings, as extremely professional, productive working relationship. I think it's probably worth noting that, of course, when we're sat across the table in those negotiations, we sat across the table from people who are very knowledgeable about Audit Scotland, knowledgeable about the accounts, knowledgeable about the finances, and therefore, you know, they will approach it in that way. And I think that all helps to provide for that environment, which is, I think, reasonable and very professional and productive. You know, at the beginning of the negotiations, you know, the PCS branch will have a different view from us in terms of what's available, what's affordable, and so on, as you might expect. But I do think it could be described as a very effective working relationship. Stephen mentioned the objective this year for the pay award to have both the negotiations and hopefully arrive at a conclusion a lot earlier than we've been in a position to do over the course of the last couple of years. And indeed, it's either Thursday this week or Tuesday next week is when we've got our first formal negotiating meeting for the year to come. And we've got a shared objective, is as far as we reasonably can, to arrive at a conclusion to those negotiations in the early part of next year, so that members of staff aren't seeing the kind of delay in terms of the award being arrived at and then in their pay packets for next year. So certainly that's our objective. And with the kind of working relationship that we've got with the union, I'm quite optimistic that we should be in a position to do that next year.
It was quite an important achievement to get the agreement that we got in October, November, and able to pay that at the end of November, because it, as it were, it cleared the decks and we could then talk very early about 2024-25. And as Stephen has indicated, it would be imprudent at the moment to put any numbers on it, but we might put something of an indicative timetable of it on it, as Martin has done. We hope that by starting now, we will have concluded an agreement before the end of the current financial year. And that would be a signal achievement, because it hasn't happened in my time on the board, to get to the point where people actually get their new pay, and the April pay packet would be a major achievement. I'm not promising that, but that's an expression of hope rather than of expectation, but that's what we're aiming for.
Okay, those are useful and full answers, so I'll go back to yourself, Convener.
Thank you. Just from what we've been talking about, I'd just like to pick up on one or two points. Back to pensions, you were saying that the indications were that there might be a lower expectation of what might be payable on pensions in the future, presumably because of bond yield changes and so on. I presume the accounting for that will simply be a reduced contribution.
Yeah, I think that's our expectation, Chair, that our employer contribution will be lower as a consequence of the factors that you mentioned, that these are bound by actuarial assumptions and so forth about what the pension scheme requires of employer members, such as us, to support its financial position. There's been a lot of volatility in, you know, pension valuations. What we have had is predictability, though, about our employer contributions, and that's an approach and mechanism that we value in terms of our financial planning. The detail of that we expect we'll have clarity of in the early part of the new year, and it's our intention just to remain in touch with the Commission once we know more.
And just moving on, there's been several references made to the audit modernisation project, which is part of your strategic improvement programme. I think the Commission would be interested in learning more about that. If there was anything you can supply us that would give us a little bit of better, more in-depth information.
Yeah, very happy to come back to you in writing as you wish, Chair. At a high level, we expect that, and that we recognise that public bodies, the Parliament, the public themselves, that Audit Scotland's work remains of a high quality, is delivered timely and adapts to changing circumstances. Our approach is currently evaluated through external quality assessment arrangements. We've had external quality approaches in place now for a number of years, firstly with the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland and now with the Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales, who provide external assessment arrangements of us. We've invested in our internal quality approach too, through establishment of a new business group, Innovation and Quality. Quality bit, I think we are on a much stronger base than we were if we go back 3 years ago. What we want to do now is the investment on the innovation approach, that we are remain nimble and deliver high quality, relevant work. We are looking at our approach, and that is the fundamental part of that for our annual financial audit activity, Chair. There are changing auditing standards, accounting standards are changing too, expectations increasing. Those are the pillars of our approach. That's governed by a strategic improvement project board that oversees our work on audit methodology. As we touch on in our submission, it's our intention over the course of really the early part of 2024, doing that research into, you know, what systems might give us the necessary arrangements to embed a new audit methodology, and then how we take that forward through, you know, learning development with our colleagues. We're very happy to come back to the Commission with more detail as you wish on that.
That would be interesting.
I wonder, Chair, if we might just consider the possibility, not today, but over the next 6 months, that we might devote one of our business planning days to looking at what's emerging from our development of our business case, because this is big stuff. I mean, we're in a position where Audit Scotland is going to have to be at the same level of performance as the private sector audit companies, and we'll at some point, probably in the first 6 months of 2024, we might be in a position to do that at a roundtable discussion at our offices or here.
I think that's something certainly worth considering, because, as you say, it seems to be an extremely important area that we need to explore. But just continuing on this, looking at the costs related to this, my understanding is that in the budget figures for next year, there's £148,000 included for the initial stages of this. But on page 12, paragraph 48, it says, at this stage, and talking about the budget here, it does not, this is your projections, does not include the potential additional requirements to meet demand arising from the audit modernisation project. So that would imply that the 25-26 and 26-27 figures that you're showing do not reflect potential costs for this modernisation project.
Quite correct, Chair. I think what we've hopefully been clear in our submission is that we will be reviewing our requirements, what the market has on offer, what that means for our delivery of our audit work, whether there's any implications for our operating model over the course of this year. So our projections for 25, 26, 26, 27 that you have are that. They're the best information that we have available today to give you indicative figures, but we don't yet know what it means in terms of our technology investment discussed with Mr. Ruskell a moment or two ago. So as we know more, and I think the Chair's suggestion is a good one, we're very keen to engage with the SCPA further as we work through 2024 and then compile our budget submission to the SCPA this time next year.
Okay, that sounds like a good idea. I'm looking at page 14, paragraph 59. This is in connection with the price reductions that were obtained from audit companies. It says here the price reductions secured in the last two appointment rounds were not sustainable. Presumably we knew they weren't sustainable at the time. Why did they give them?
So yes, we did know they weren't sustainable, but we were happy to receive them nonetheless. So effectively, the private firms at that point offered discounts on the rates that they submitted to acquire audit appointments from the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission. The cost of audit across the piece has increased. In a commercial audit context, public sector audit, and I think, as I remember discussion with the SCPA in previous meetings, drawing your attention to the cost of local audit in England has increased by 150%. There are certain factors there that are relevant, but it doesn't mask overall that audit costs are increasing because of increased regulation, changes in technology, new auditing, new accounting standards. So really, in terms of that comment here, yeah, we knew that the cost was going to increase, but when we were offered the discounts, we thought it was the right thing to accept, going back, you know, 6 and 11 years ago.
I think it's worth adding to that, Chair, that I chaired the working group that organised the process of the new audit appointments. And at the beginning of that, we were aware that the prices that we had before were unsustainable. But we're also aware that there was no guarantee that anybody was going to bid. And I mention this because having the private firms involved gives us access to the kind of market intelligence that allows us to plan ahead and say, OK, we're realistic about this. And I think it's also worth just underlining to the Commission that the arrangement that Stephen alluded to earlier, whereby the fees that we pay to the external firms is pegged to the increase in our staff costs. That is a very good deal for public audit in Scotland. But given where we are, I wouldn't want to forecast that we would be any more certain at the beginning of the process for the next quinquennium than we were at the back in 2019.
Just moving to page 15, paragraph 75. It's highlighted here that other operating costs are 9.3% higher in the 24-25 budget compared to the approved 23-24 budget. Given that we don't actually have figures for actuals for 23-24, is there any comment on how we are performing in comparison to that budget?
We can happily share that with the Commission. As Stuart's touched on, we have a quarterly reporting that we provide to our executive team and our board that they are cited on progress, and we can provide that to the Commission. But our forecast informs our budget, Chair. So the numbers that you have before you as part of the proposed budget will be made with reference to known changes, but also the pattern of expenditure that we have in the current 23-24 year and where that leads us to is the proposal that you have before you. So we'll follow that up in writing to share with you our interim arrangements.
That would be useful because the actual figures against the proposed budget for 24-25 actually make more sense to us than looking at the budget for the previous year.
Certainly, and the forecast can support that comparison.
Okay, can I ask if any members have any other questions they would like to ask? No? In that case, I'll thank Stephen Boyle, Alan Alexander, Martin Walker and Stuart Dennis for attending today. And I'll move the meeting into private session. And we'll suspend for just a few minutes to allow a change of system for our remote people.